Today I have 5 clocks to show you. They're all by Smiths and they all have Bakelite cases of the same basic design. This one is the most important to me personally because this is an exact replica of one I bought in 1985 when I was 21 years old. I bought a clock exactly like this, plus a silvery coloured 8-day French alarm clock for £7 the pair. Yes, those were the days. And this one is exactly the same as that Smith's clock I bought that day, with the purple and gold dial centre with a radial design. And that Smith's trademark that you can just see behind the hour hand there. Quite a small striking clock with a pendulum controlled 8-day movement. And the following year, 1986, I was in Glasgow. I went to the Barras, which is a big market area, and I bought a clock exactly like this one. And I was intrigued because it's the first clock I'd seen since I bought this one to have the same case, but it had a different dial and a timepiece only movement. And it was £3.50. And I saw it and I thought, do I want that? And I thought, I'll think about it. The next day I went back and I bought it. It didn't have a pendulum, so I had to share the pendulum with the other clock I had. And because the pendulum's a slightly different length, I had to regulate it. I had to screw the pendulum down a lot before it would keep time. Which was a bit strange, but oh well. And this one has the Smith's Enfield trademark. But it's the same case, same bezel, and same hands. And the timepiece only movement has mostly the same wheel work. Okay. Since this one's easiest to get to, I'll show you the movement. I had to spend a while cleaning this case when I got it. It was very rough, it was a bit dull. For some reason, the timepiece only Smith's Enfield Aberdeen clocks didn't have a black painted pendulum. Most Smith's clocks at this time had the pendulum painted black, but the timepiece only Smith's Aberdeen didn't for some reason. I put new bushes in these top two pivots here. You might be able to see them. So when I got this clock, it had two very, very slack pivots there. It's now going quite well. It's going a little bit slow, so I need to regulate it a little. Now, because this is based on the striking clock case, it still has this leather panel to let out sound, even though there's no sound to let out. And where the gong would be mounted, there is this bit of screw-threaded metal with a square washer on each end of it, which seems a bit strange, but these cases were made for striking clocks, so that's why that's there. And a nice touch of detail, a Smith's Enfield key for a clock with a Smith's Enfield name, and a Smith's key for a clock with a Smith's name. Now this one's a tight fit in here, so I won't take this one out to show you the movement, but I have another one that's more accessible, which I'll now show you. So this is an exact replica of one I bought in 1988 from a retired local jeweller who had just closed his business down. So I went down to his shop and bought a lot of stuff off him, tools, spares, and old incomplete clocks, and he came out with this one. I thought, oh, that's interesting. It's exactly the same as the timepiece Smith's Enfield clock that I bought at the Barris in Glasgow, but this has the striking movement. So I was thinking, well, I probably wouldn't have bought it if it was at an auction sale, but since I was just given it as part of the job lot, I was intrigued with it. So this is one I bought fairly recently. Of course, it has the Smith's Enfield name on it, and it has the right key, and I'll try and get this out of here so I can show you the movement. And there it is. That pendulum bob I don't think belongs to it, because I've never seen a Smith's Aberdeen with that size of pendulum. It won't go now since I've turned it round. The shelf unit's not exactly level. But that is the movement. Quite a large movement for quite a small case. But this was one of the most popular Smith's clocks of the 1950s. There are a huge number of them around. The typical Smith's Enfield gong sound. Actually, the other one that I showed you with the purple and gold dial centre, it has a different gong, a sort of softer sound. Interestingly, the pendulum length on the Smith's Enfield Aberdeen is slightly longer than on the Smith's Aberdeen that had the purple and gold dial centre. So if you have two of these clocks, the Smith's and the Smith's Enfield next to each other, you'll find Smith's one ticks slightly faster than the Smith's Enfield one. It's quite a strange phenomenon. Okay, clock number four. The Smith's Aberdare. This is the first of those that I've ever owned. I bought it a few weeks ago. It needed a good clean as well. It's based on the same design as the Smith's Aberdeen. It's the same case, but made with a lighter coloured Bakelite. Different chapter ring, and it has brass plated hands instead of gold painted hands. So here it is close up. You see the nice shiny hands on it. And the Smith's trademark. And yes, that is a very unusual colour of Bakelite, but Smith's used that colour of Bakelite at one time. It was meant to look like wood grain, I think. Which it doesn't really. It looks kind of like bar walnut. It is kind of unusual. This is the most important feature of the Smith's Aberdare. It uses the floating balance movement, which was a new innovation at that time. Of course, this is the front winding version of the Smith's floating balance movement. Because they made a rear winding version as well. Let you hear it. That's the same gong as the Smith's Aberdeen with the purple and gold dial centre. It was a bit tightly wedged in its space, so I didn't turn it round to let you see the inside of it. But this was the Smith's Aberdare, and it was only in production for about 2 years. Fifth and finally, I don't know what the name of this model is. It's based on the Aberdeen case again. It's the dark Bakelite as used in the Smith's Aberdeen, not that bur walnut coloured Bakelite used in the Aberdare. But this clock also uses a floating balance movement in a rear winding configuration. And as you see, it has a larger dial. That bezel doesn't open, so the clock is set from the rear. I'll let you see it. It's not easy holding the camera with one hand. The case never varies much in these clocks, and that is the movement. Rear winding floating balance movement. It's running slightly slow, so I'll regulate it. So this clock, you have to pick it up, turn it around and open it up to wind it up, which is kind of unusual. Also, that is the floating balance gong, which in my opinion doesn't sound very good. It's a bit dead sounding. But that is the later gong as used on Smith's floating balance clocks. And there's no name on this clock. I've seen a few of these clocks before. I have no idea what they're called. So I'd call it the late model Aberdare, since it has the floating balance movement. I don't know about you, but it just somehow doesn't look right with that larger dial. It doesn't look in proportion somehow. But maybe that's just because I'm used to seeing those other ones. I'm used to seeing the Smith's Aberdeen with the small opening bezel. So this one is just a bit unconventional. It's difficult to say if I have a favourite among these, but they're all worthy additions to my collection. Okay, if you like this video, please click like and subscribe. My Facebook link is down below, and my PayPal link if you would like to support this channel. And I'll see you in the next video.